see so many faces of so many friends. I spent 10 of the happiest years of my life in this community. And I don't know if you know this, but when I was elected bishop, St. Francis gave me this pectoral cross, and I've worn it for over 20 years, right here, right next to my heart. It's good to see you again. Let me take you back almost 800 years, back to the 13th century, and to the faraway coastline of Egypt. A small sailing boat makes land after crossing the Mediterranean from a country we now call Italy. Two men disembark and stand on the shore. Both are simply dressed, carrying with them neither food nor money. One of them is Francis, not yet a saint, really just a wandering holy man with a wild, unkempt appearance. And the other is called Illuminatus, which means, of course, light. They have come alone and unarmed on a long and perilous journey with a single purpose: to try to stop the Crusades. The year was 1219. This was the year of the Fifth Crusade. The first four hadn't gone very well, and the fifth would end in disaster. Europe was engaged in an all-out war with Islam in what was the first and fateful clash of civilizations. The Pope in Rome had called upon Christian kings and princes to send armies to rescue Jerusalem from Muslim control. Thousands on both sides were being slaughtered. And Francis was appalled by this. In an act of defiance of his own pope, and some said of his own people, he got into a boat and made that perilous journey across the sea, a striking reversal of the same journey so many have taken in the last few years in the opposite direction. A journey to appeal for peace and mercy and forgiveness. The Muslims of Egypt were long accustomed to wandering holy men. There had been Christians in Egypt for 1,000 years, Coptic Christians, some of them hermits, some desert preachers, and all of them regarded as heretics by the Pope and the Latin West. Francis asked to be taken to see the Sultan. Now, the Sultan was a sophisticated man, a nephew of the famous Saladin, and he had tried to stop the Crusades himself, first by diplomacy, and then of necessity by force. He agreed to meet Francis and began by asking who sent him. Francis replied he had been sent by no man, but by God. For a few days, they each tried to convert the other to their own religion. And when this failed, something extraordinary happened. They both began to see God in each other. They spent weeks in conversation. Persuasion gave way to listening. It was not the first, but it certainly was one of the most significant acts of dialogue between what are now the world's two largest religions. When Francis decided to go home, the Sultan showered him with gifts, but Francis refused them all because of his vow of poverty. He took only one thing, a horn used by Muslim imams to summon the faithful to prayer. Francis was deeply impressed by their discipline of prayer 5 times a day. And when he got back home, he urged Christians to do the same. You can see that horn preserved today in the Basilica in Assisi. Now, we would do well to reflect on this story today, because we live in a time when our image and impression of Muslims are shaped not by their cultured leaders, nor by their sophisticated scholars or poets, their universities and their art, but our images and impressions of Islam are shaped by a tiny minority of fanatical clergy and their brainwashed, demented, violent followers. We would do well to reflect on what the clash of civilizations has done to the history of the world, how so many efforts at peaceful understanding and mutual acceptance have been crushed under the force of religious bigotry and political exploitation driven by money and greed. This week particularly has been an assault on human dignity. The atrocity in Manchester was followed by the massacre of Christian pilgrims in Egypt. Then we saw the President of the United States speaking to Arab leaders in the Middle East, confidently declaring to Palestinians and Israelis that, quote, we can get this peace deal done, unquote, while at the same time selling billions of dollars of armaments to Saudi Arabia. There was a small ray of light this week when the President met the Pope, whose name, incidentally, is Francis. And the Pope gave him a copy of his encyclical on the environment. Some of you I know have traveled to the Middle East. Some of you perhaps have been to Jerusalem. And that's also significant today because this is Jerusalem Sunday all across Canada. It's a day when we pray for that city and its people, and our church in the Holy Land. The Anglican Diocese of Jerusalem covers 6 countries in that region. It operates 26 hospitals, clinics, and schools, as well as its parish churches. The students in the Anglican schools are mostly Muslims. The patients in the Anglican hospitals are mostly Muslims. There are few Christians left in the land of Jesus, but those who are there minister to everyone. Christians in the Holy Land tend to be better educated, and so they have the ability to leave and go overseas to study and take work. But once emigrated, the law of the land does not allow them to return. Those who do stay are deeply committed to the work of peace and reconciliation. They work with other Muslims and with many Jews who are trying to keep alive the struggling peace process. They deserve at least our prayers. And if you are minded to do more than that, I encourage you to go online and make a small donation to their desperately underfunded hospitals and clinics. In the scripture readings today, Jesus says to his disciples, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." And after saying these words, Jesus disappeared from their earthly sight. The Spirit of God came upon them with great force, and it did indeed lead them to the ends of the earth, as it led Francis across the sea. We are now the emissaries and missionaries of the Holy Spirit. It is our duty to use our gifts and talents, our blessings and good fortune, to be the agents of mercy and forgiveness in the name of Jesus Christ. We will need the same courage as they did, and we will need the same freedom to challenge the assumptions and conventions of our time. The same strength to resist the manipulation and coercion of political and religious conformity. And to help us do this, to inspire us in our own spiritual lives, we have these beautiful windows. These windows are designed for us to be an aid to prayer and to meditation, to reflect upon not only the past, but the present and the future. The Canticle of St. Francis, now complete in this little church and many years in the making, is our sign and our inspiration. From now on, we and the generations behind us will be wrapped in the colors and prayers of this grace-filled light. They invite us to embrace life in all its mystery and diversity. They invite us to befriend one another. And they invite us to befriend the strangers whom we may fear. They teach us that the Spirit of God is in everything and in everyone, and that not even fire or storm or death can triumph over faith and trust in God. They bring the joy of Francis from far away Italy, right here into Caulfield Cove. We give thanks to God for those who have designed and built and given these windows, for they are a spiritual work of grace in a world that so often obscures human generosity. Francis is perhaps the most loved saint in all of Christianity, because his heart and his soul were fixed entirely on God. He was not a gloomy figure, but a cheerful person. He wanted to stop violence in the name of religion. He wanted to heal the wounds of separation in the natural order, between humans and animals, between rich and poor. And he wanted to remind all humanity about the harmony of God's creation. The 13th century, when he lived, was a time when most Christians thought God to be a stern and remote judge, a frightening tyrant, casting a gloomy eye over human sin and unworthiness, and sending millions to hell and torment. That was the God the church in those days preached. But Francis preached a different gospel, a message of love that embraces everything, a love that comes from the heart of a compassionate God. And this is what these windows so perfectly capture. This is what this little church in the woods stands for. This is the gospel we believe here. I urge you to have the courage of Jesus and his servant Francis to stand against disordered religion and violent politics, and to be witnesses of our Lord Jesus Christ to the ends of the earth. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.